Early on, as a little girl, my mom tells me that I said to her, we were watching the, I want to say the Grammys, and I said to her, Mommy, you see that lady singing right there? One day that's going to be me on TV, just like her. And so I've been singing so long. In fact, my mother said I kind of was singing before I was able to talk. And so I've been singing since I was 3. I sang my first solo when I was 8, my first professional gig at 12, and I'm 48. So that gives you some idea of how long I've been singing. It's what I believe I was born to do. I don't think it's the only thing that I do, but it is certainly the precursor for everything else, you know, the even the preaching and all of my relationship to God. I think my gift is a way that I bridge the gap sometime when I feel lost or when I feel without guidance, when I feel in dark places. It's the music that does a lot to bring me out of it. And I'm told a lot of the people that listen to my music as well, so that's a great thing. Absolutely. I think some of the best songs are stories. Certainly, it's the simple songs that get the biggest play because they're the sing-alongs. However, if you would stretch your mind a little bit and reach for some different things, I think you'll find that some of the, for me as an artist, some of the more grander songs have always been the songs with stories, even sometimes stories that we can't understand. If you think about Stevie Wonder's songs in the Key of Life, and he does rainbow moonbeams and orange snow on Saturn, people live to be 205. I think that's a great lyric, you know? I mean, I want to get inside of his head and say, what made you think of such a thing? You know, stories. You know, they're the greatest songs. Those are the songs that I know, those are the songs that sit with me the most. They're the ones that inspire me to write. And they kind of give you a peek. They give you a little bit of a peek into the artist as a person, the places that they can go that maybe some other artists can't necessarily go, can't reach. You know, so, and depending on how well they tell the story also adds to, you know, them as an artist. So I try to expound upon that and reflect those things in my music. Even when I'm singing songs that come directly out of the scriptures, you know, I want to make sure that I tell a story to help folk to be able to see what God is actually saying and to be able to come around to being able to live the life that we're trying to sing about. I think all the songs that I write are me. Ready for that question.
Are there any songs in particular, maybe even like a couple of songs, where you go, that felt really good to write?
There's a song that I wrote on Love Forever Shines that I had actually written 8 years before I actually recorded it. And the song says, I'll Never Leave You Alone. And the song is dealing with, at the time, I was in a hotel room in Detroit. I was feeling really just like God forgotten about me. I was feeling really separated, really in distance. And I had gotten down on my knees and started praying. And something in my spirit said, you're not low enough. And so, you know, I got off the bed and, you know, I kind of kneeled down and said, you're still not low enough. So I laid my face down, you know, just prostrate, just got on the floor. And I began to pray. And I was crying and I was moaning and I was, you know, and I still couldn't hear God. I couldn't feel God. And I got up off my knees and I started washing my face. And all of a sudden, these words came to me. And the song just simply said, I'll never leave you alone. And I think recording that song gave me the best feeling of all time, because that song actually came into fruition from the state that I was in and to a place of where God allowed his precious gift of time to heal what I was feeling at that point, to now come to a place where I could sing the song in freedom from the bondage that I felt at the time when I wrote the song. And so I think for me, that was probably the most profound song for me in my life to have ever written because of the nature of the song. But in terms of songs that that just make you kind of get up and go, is a song that I wrote called Mighty in Battle. And I wanted it to be an anthem. I wanted it to be something where when you hear it, not only do you want to shake a little bit, but you actually go through your day. The Lord is mighty in battle, mighty in power, mighty in strength, our strong tower, and the King of Glory shall come in. And who is the King of Glory? The Lord is. And it's just basically saying that the Lord is on my side. Great is he that lives in me, that he who is in the world. I know that if, as long as I am attached to God, my Savior, my covering, my keeper, my provider, that I'm not in this fight alone. Regardless of what it is I go through. And there may be some days where I cry. There may be some days where I get down. Maybe even some days where I get depressed. But being a child of God, you can't stay there. There's something in you that will rise up because it's greater. God will take the privilege in you, the right in you, to lift up the standard so that you don't continue to live like that, so you can continue to see things like that. And I thank God that through music, he's given me an opportunity to spiritually visualize things that we can't otherwise see with carnal eyes. And so music is a huge tool in my life to be able to help me in so many different ways, and hopefully to help others to be able to come past that place of just living. But Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. So, you know, Mighty in Battle is certainly the song that is it's that feel-good thing that make you just want to move and get you through your day, get you through your job, you know, driving down the street, you know, you might drive a little bit too fast, so you might have to cut it down a little bit. It's that kind of song. You know, how far you've come. I've come a long ways. I had to deal with a few things. I had to, you know, kind of pull myself out of some situations from that time, because 8 years now, 9, 10, it's more like 11 years now since I wrote that song. In 2009, I experienced brain surgery. And, you know, when you think about, when someone gives you a prognosis, they gotta cut your head open literally because you have a tumor, it's not really a positive, nobody has a positive outlook on it. Granted, we may come to that place, but the first response, and I pray that, you know, if I didn't respond right, that God forgives me and he'd give me a better response, you know, provided I have some other serious situation to look at later on. But my first response was like, I don't believe this. This can't be. And I just remembered, you know, my dad always saying, let your will be done. Let your will be done. And so I kept reciting that to myself. And then I remember getting in the operating room, and just before they gave me the anesthesia, and I said, Lord, let your will be done, but if I could make the desires of my heart known, you know, allow me to be in my right mind when I come out of here. Allow me to remember my children, my husband, my mother, my father, my brother, you know, my sisters, and let me remember you, God, my keeper. You know, it's a hard time. 10 months of not being able to dress yourself and get yourself out of bed, and, you know, on different occasions, getting so dizzy that, you know, get sick, you know, it was a really, really hard time. You know, but I thank God that he didn't leave me there. And I truly believe, as a result of some of the things that I've been through in my life, some things that I had no hand in, it just happened. And then those things that I had a hand in that I messed up in, I truly believe that as I live life and I get closer to God, that my ladder will be greater than my beginning. And I may never get the Grammys that I've gotten through R&B, but I've achieved something much greater, a better sense of self-worth. That I am the head and not the tail, that I will live and not die. And so the great thing about where I am in the transition of my life is that each day I get a little bit stronger, a little bit more stronger. Each day I understand things a little bit better. And if nothing else, I understand just how smart I am now. You know, it's like when I went to Rutgers and I started learning all these things about, you know, history and all these different things, and I started really figuring out how dumb I really am, you know. So I thank God that he's given me the humility to understand that I am so not in charge, but I can still have a fruitful life, and I can be a witness for somebody else. So that's pretty much in terms of transitioning in my life. Those are some of the, I think, the pearls of wisdom. Wow, I wish I'd written that song. That is Sam D's. I can't take any credit for that. It is by far one of my favorite songs of all time. The song reminds me of my grandparents. My grandmother on September 15th just celebrated her 100th birthday. And before my grandfather died, they had been married for 61 years. And to me, After the Love Has Lost Its Shine was the epitome of their marriage. That it wasn't always great. They had some arguments, they had some disagreements. But through it all, they were able to stick together through good times and through bad times. Give birth to 8 children. All my father's brothers and sisters are still living. They have a wonderful silent legacy because a lot of people may not know about them throughout the world. But they are a great legacy to me because they are an example that I'm able to touch to say, this is how you stay together, this is how you pull through it, you know. And it says, and until all the glitter's gone, we'll be hanging on to make it even stronger. True love will never die long after the love has lost its shine. Well, we all know that first date wears off after the first date. And so if there is no substance behind it, then you really don't have much. After the love exemplifies getting to know one another and not just jumping straight into the bedroom, not just jumping straight into the sexual activity, but actually getting to know a person, becoming a friend, becoming somebody who you depend on for more than just the intimacy of. But the intimacy of friendship. You know, I share your goals. I support you in your dreams. You know, those types of things. That song means all of that to me. So again, another example of great storytelling through a song. Wow, history changed my life. History was the teacher, the mother, and my mother is great. I thank God to have the kind of mother that I have because I didn't have to read about her in a book. My mother was my hero. She was my first hero, she's still my hero. But history became the mother of calmness in me. I had a lot of issues growing up, being darker. My mother's light, really long hair, and although I'm wearing some long hair today, it's not really mine. and yet I digress. I had some issues, you know. I had an issue with the whole black thing, you know. History helped me with learning how to be proud of myself. When I began to study history in about maybe, and I, when I say history, I mean the true history. About eighth grade, I had eighth grade history teacher, who made us put our books aside. And she brought in books. And she said, this is what we're going to learn from. That was my first introduction to real history. Finding out that Christopher Columbus didn't discover America. You know, how could you discover a land where there's already people there? And just different things, different little niches. And so it sparked my curiosity. And so it went from being excited about learning that there is history of our people beyond slavery and the portrayals of black people in Africa with a bone in your nose and, you know, it went much further. All the different things that we've contributed, you know, that society still utilizes. I just was excited. My whole thing about history turned around. My whole aspect of how I thought about reading. Now, I was excited to read, you know. And it went from there to being very angry. Because I went from the place of African roots and in my family where Irish, African, and Cherokee Indian on my mom's side. And so I started learning about the transition from Africa and then some of our ancestors who were already here. And I went from there to an extreme anger, just mad all the time. And I didn't have a good way of venting it. There was no way to get rid of it. And so I was mad for like, ninth grade to 11th grade. And then all of a sudden in 11th grade, when I started, I read something that Frederick Douglass said, and he said, I stopped being a slave when I learned how to read. And that changed my whole life when I read that little niche, because I understood that now you can still be enslaved today if you don't have knowledge. You can be in bondage. If you can't recognize where it is that you can go and what it is you can do with your life and all the people that paid the dues for you to get to where you are just to be able to walk through a front door, then guess what? You are in slavery and you deserve to be today. And so when I started understanding that, then there was a certain calmness. So that's why I say history, it excited me, it angered me, but then it calmed me because I found a place for all those different things, so, because basically I came to the understanding, okay, so what do you do now? What do we do with this knowledge now? So since you're so mad, Miss Regina, where do you plan to take this? You know, what are you gonna do with this? You know, even today my kids joke and say, oh, don't say bad hair around mommy. You know, yeah, because I'm not trying to hear it. You know, I tell them all the time, I said, no hair is bad hair. And I can't even say that because my dad shaved all his hair off, so. And he looks great, so I can't even say that anymore. But, you know, history is exciting. You know, and in some respects, I would believe to say that, I'd be remiss to say that it saved my life in a lot of different ways. You know, it helped me. It helped my lens, my 2020. It brought things into view that I never could see before. And it brought an understanding of how we act, how we react, you know, why we're in some of the positions that we're in. And then it made me proud all at the same time, because now I'm proud to be dark. Now I'm proud to be of my descent, where I come from. I'm proud to be all of those different things, because I look at some of the greatest accomplishments. There was no other race of people that could have come through the things that we came through. No other race, because they tried other races. Didn't work. And so there is, I guess, a great thing that comes even out of slavery. that we have to acknowledge. And so I have to say that history has done a lot to shape me and mold me into the person that I am today. And without it, I would be a very different person, probably not even behind this camera, had I not had some of the lessons in history and some great teachers. I mean, I actually studied under Ida Van Sertima. He was one of my professors at Rutgers University. And so, you know, I studied with some of the great Dr. Ralph Carter. I'm taught a class at Rutgers. So I came under some really great people to gain some really great knowledge. The ships coming in, the Isabella, to what they must have thought coming to a land so far away from theirs, seeing winters for the first time, the whole change of diet, the taking away of religion, it's so many different. The Amy Church, Richard Allen, the things that they experience, going into a place where you're supposed to find salvation, and yet there's segregation, and a place that's supposed to give you freedom. It's such an oxymoron. They don't even belong in the same sentence. What he must have felt. And to boldly go forth and say, "You're not going to take this. God is not that kind of God." And to separate and say, salvation is for us as well. The Bible is for us. The Word of God is for us as well. I mean, there's so many different things, because I'm not the type of person to approach anything just surface-wise. So I got in some books, I got on the internet, and, you know, I dug in to find some things. And so when you bring all of that to the plate and you put all of this on the table and you're writing a song that says freedom, the task becomes, how do I say this? Because you don't need to be real deep. Because simple is deep. And so when you say the chant freedom, what mama prayed and cried for, what daddy stuck his neck out for, it was the freedom to live for every man, woman, boy, and girl. And so it wasn't about assimilating with another race to have those things. It was the belief that that should be for everybody across the board. And not just from slavery, but in jobs, housing, studying about Octavius Cato, just some of the people that I came across, it was mind-blowing to see some of the things that they had accomplished, just so that, again, I could be behind this camera to talk about them and to be able to have some of the benefits that I have today. Again, my mind gets blown every time I go into a history book to find out what we've done. But the greatest thing is to be able to contribute this song, not just to Philadelphians, but this is where it started. This is the stage where it started to get the idea going to write the song. So I'm excited because I woke Ivan up, I think, one night around 11:30. Or maybe it's 12 o'clock in the morning. And my assistant, Ivan Taylor, was, I'm not calling that man. I said, give me the number. I will call him myself. Okay? And I called the brother. And I started, you know, reciting off some of the things that I wanted to do. And I was like, well, how do you feel about this? And I said, I'm really sorry for waking you up, but I'm in the studio now. And I want to get it right. It's important to me to get this right. And being this wealth of knowledge that he is, he was only so willing to share with me some different things about what I need to put in, some things I need to take out, and hence the song Freedom. That's how you get it. It's my desire that everyone that's black, white, brown, whomever, learn about who we are as a people. However, it is our responsibility to pass that wealth of knowledge down to our young people. The biggest problem with sometimes having children and you're still a child yourself is that there are certain things that you haven't learned. There are things that you haven't come across. So you're not equipped, and now you're bringing another life into the world who is not equipped, who does not have the armor to protect themselves from the things that they're going to feel that the world's going to strike out against them. And so it is my it's my dream, it's my desire, and it's my goal to extend that to every young person, so that when I have to pass the baton, that I'm not passing the baton to a foolish person. I'm not passing the baton who don't have to someone who doesn't have any idea how to lead. That they've been a follower their entire life and they don't know how to step up to the plate, and now it's their turn to bat. So it's my desire that our young people will come in to this museum and that they will partake of the knowledge. And just like the words of the Bible, hide it in their heart. And at the appropriate time, it will be manifested for themselves as well as those who are around them.